So for reading 5.1, and I wanted to provide a little bit more context to really what is the big picture that the article's talking about and why it matters in sort of the broader sense. And so we need to view a few things sort of in order to get to the point where you might see the impact of the article. The first thing we need to know is that the US Supreme Court has to appear as a legitimate institution in order to actually be effective within our government. If the US Supreme Court does not appear legitimate, and that is to say, if the majority of the American public does not see it as a legitimate institution to resolve these conflicts, they're sort of at a loss because they're dependent upon other branches of government, mainly the executive and legislative, to actually enforce their decisions. When since the executive and legislative are tied directly to the people through elections, if the Supreme Court's is not viewed as legitimate, there provides little incentive for the executive and legislature to carry out their rulings. And so the Supreme Court has to appear legitimate in order to be effective in our governmental system. But one thing we know that does affect the appearance of legitimacy, or does affect legitimacy of the court generally, is if it appears to be in conflict. That is to say, most Americans think of the act of judging as one that is sort of mechanical, that you look at the facts vis-a-vis the law, and the outcome should be pretty much predictable. That's not the case, especially with the U.S. Supreme Court, in which these are legitimate questions in the law, where the law may appear to be conflicting with the Constitution, or where there simply is no good answer based upon precedent. So when conflict occurs on the court, which it is not rare, that sort of conflict magnifies the battle for legitimacy that the court is fighting out. To provide a tad bit of context with this, the Brown v. Board of Education decision, Chief Justice Earl Warren fought over a year to make sure that the court was going to be unanimous with that decision, because he wanted that decision to appear to be as legitimate as it possibly could be when the court made it. And so the court sort of attempts to, at times, reduce this conflict in order to appear more legitimate. Now, shifting sort of to the tone of the article, we know that media, broadcast, print, all sorts of media, reporting prioritizes that conflict generally in every sort of context, that if there exists conflict, that's what media is going to report on, primarily because, and we always need to remember this about the media, their goal is to sell whatever product it is that they're putting out, be it newspaper, broadcast, what have you. And the reason for that is the more someone consumes their product, the more they can charge for advertising. And they know that conflict in terms of reporting increases readership and viewership, and therefore they're able to make more money based on advertising. So the media prioritizes this conflict. And so when the media reports on the court, they tend to prioritize this conflict. But what we also know, especially from the readings in 5.1, is that the conflict that it reports on is not absolutely reflected in the actual amount of conflict that the court has. If we look at simply dissent rates on the court, they're nowhere near as high as as reporting in terms of the Supreme Court conflict would make it seem. So the media plays up the amount of conflict that there exists on the court. Now, the Supreme Court is shielded institutionally from the other branches of government. So the executive and the legislative can't really directly affect the United States Supreme Court. We know that they can't force Supreme Court justices to recuse. We know that the justices have life tenure. We know that outside of really removing the discretionary jurisdiction or the appellate jurisdiction of the United States Supreme Court, that neither of the other two branches of government can really do anything to directly affect the court. However, we couple this with our first point. We know that in order for the Supreme Court to actually carry out their decisions, they have to appear legitimate. And we know that one of the things that can cause the court to appear illegitimate is conflict, and we know that media plays up the conflict that exists on the court. So we need to ask a very simple question. Might the Supreme Court follow public opinion in order to raise their legitimacy? So that is to say that a court that is what we think of as judicially independent, that is immune from the other branches of government. But judicial independence also means immune from the populace. We remember we don't elect our United States Supreme Court justices, that they are entirely immune from any sort of direct accountability from either the public or the other two branches of government. But if the Supreme Court knows they have to prioritize the legitimacy, we might come down to a circumstance where the Supreme Court will follow, to some degree, public opinion in order to maintain that legitimacy, and thereby reducing conflict. So they reduce conflict and they maintain the legitimacy. That may happen. That's actually an empirical question and one that actually needs study. But that's what this article is leading into, is that media plays up conflict. What does that mean for the court? Well, I'm tossing out a hypothetical that the court may, in those circumstances, as they see legitimacy fall, possibly on the back of a reporting that prioritizes the conflict that does exist on the court, though not to the extent that the reporting does, that the court may actually, at some point, even though they are structurally and institutionally independent from the public, may look to public opinion to inform them how to make decisions, thereby bolstering the legitimacy of the court. Now, what does this mean for the court? Well, the number one power that the U.S. Supreme Court has is what is known as judicial review. And judicial review is the authority of the branch to review the actions of the other branches of government and possibly declare them unconstitutional. That is the biggest tool in the Supreme Court's arsenal. In fact, the biggest tool in any court's arsenal. But that the argument for judicial review is predicated on the idea that these courts are independent and that they will make decisions based upon solely the dictates of the Constitution. Now, if we enter a circumstance where the legitimacy of the court is dropping, and therefore the court looks at public opinion to inform its decision, the theoretical basis for judicial review is gone. And that's something that the United States Supreme Court would need to, at least to some extent, rectify. And there are alternatives to explain how this would work. Remember, at the state level, state courts still have judicial review. They have the authority to review the other branches of government and potentially declare them unconstitutional vis-a-vis the state's constitution. Also, remember that these courts are elected. So the idea of elected courts having the authority of judicial review is not one that is impossible to imagine within a democracy. In fact, we have it here in the state of Texas, and numerous other states still have it. But it would be a significant change to the United States Supreme Court, and one that the court would have to wrestle with. We know that elected judges pay attention to what the public wants, at least on salient issues. And it's not that far of a stretch to think that the United States Supreme Court would behave in a similar way when their legitimacy is on the line.